All right, y'all. Let's react to Beyonce's new album, Cowboy Carter. Y'all ready? Let's go.
I came to vibe, came to function, just do that, baby. Don't worry about nothing, no, no, no.
All right, y'all. It's your boy Bright Tear, the R&B kid, and I'm back again with another episode of On the Bright Side TV. Welcome back. How y'all doing? Hope you're doing very well. Listen, y'all, I am so excited to bring this episode to y'all. I've been waiting for this moment. Beyonce's 8th studio album, Cowboy Carter, is finally here. I am so excited for this moment. This is act 2 in the trilogy of this Renaissance. I guess we can call it the Renaissance trilogy. I don't know. But this is act 2 in, you know, Beyonce's trilogy with her recent albums after Renaissance, which came out, you know, pretty much almost 2 years ago. And it's been crazy to think that, you know, in July, Renaissance will be 2 years old. It feels like just yesterday when the album came out. But now we have Cowboy Carter, which is act 2. Obviously, I've not heard the album yet, obviously, but, you know, we know it's a country album, or at least Beyonce said it's not a country album, it's a Beyonce album, and period. But, you know, it's a Beyonce album that's steeped in a lot of country influence. I'm sure there'll be other, you know, genres and vibes in here as well. I think I'm so excited that Beyonce seems like she's in an era in her career where she's really not being bound and held by genres, but she's really just looking to explore and just, you know, do a deeper dive into all different types of genres and just seeing what, you know, what sounds good and feels true to her. So I'm assuming with this album, even though it'll probably be mostly steeped in country, there'll be definitely other genres and other vibes in here. And I feel like it's all going to be, you know, made well, and it's all going to fit together well. But yeah, like I said, I'm really just excited for this album. I'm excited for this experience. I don't know what it'll sound like, you know, individually, all these tracks and as a whole, but I'm excited to see, you know, where Beyonce wanted to take herself and us, you know, along this new journey of hers. I feel like she's in a stage, in her career where she's not afraid to try new things. She's really not afraid to just, you know, put it all out there. And I'm excited to see, you know, what she came up with on this album. You know, we know that this album has been years in the making. Apparently, she made this album before she made Renaissance, which I think is insane. Like, this woman's mind is insane. The fact that she made this album, you know, right as the pandemic had started, you know, before Renaissance, and wanted to put this out before Renaissance initially, but then when she made Renaissance, she, you know, thinking to herself, like, nah, I want the world to dance and really just, you know, celebrate, you know, the Renaissance of kind of coming out of the pandemic and just, you know, have a moment to just breathe and feel free after the pandemic. You know, it made complete sense. So we got Renaissance first, and now that we've lived with that album and that experience and that tour and that moment, now we're in this new moment of Cowboy Carter, and I'm excited to see, you know, what this does for her career. I'm excited to see, you know, what it does for the legacy of her catalog. I'm excited to see, you know, just, you know, what it does for the fans who are not used to this sound from Beyonce. Like, I've already did my reaction to, you know, Texas Hold'em and Six and Carriages, you know, back when they came out during the Super Bowl. I hope you guys definitely checked out that video. If you haven't already, go check out that video. And I love both of those songs, especially 16 Carriages. I love Texas Hold'em too. A vibe. I'm glad I went number one on the Hot 100. But I truly love 16 Carriages. Like, I love that track. So when I first heard those tracks, I was thrown off. But I was like, at the same time, this feels very much like Beyonce. This feels like she's at home. Like, she's from Houston. Like, she's always been country since day one. Like, at the end of the day, Beyonce had to be like, you know, a pop R&B star. But she's always been a country girl at heart. So I'm happy that she's finally coming home musically and that she's really, you know, doing her part to, I wouldn't say reclaim country music as a black genre, because I don't feel like that's like the right thing to say, because country music has always been black and it started out black. So it's not like we were reclaiming anything. But I think I would say that, you know, I'm proud and happy that Beyonce's reclaiming the genre for herself. Actually, after having felt like she couldn't really proudly tap into that side of herself for several years now, as we all know. And we all know, as Beyonce said in her message on Instagram, that this album was born out of an experience where she didn't feel comfortable. I'm assuming we all think, you know, it was the 2016 CMAs. I'm assuming that was the event, because we all know what happened with that when she performed Daddy Lessons with the Dixie Chicks, or the Chicks. And that was a whole moment in itself. I love that song. I love that moment. And it's a shame that that moment wasn't celebrated, but it was, you know, fraught with, like, you know, this tension and this racial genre, you know, tension that didn't need to be there. But, you know, what it is, you know. But I love that, you know, Beyonce said, okay, instead of me, you know, being angry about this and being upset and holding this in, I'm gonna use this and put it into my art and pour it into my art. And it has now materialized in her first album that really is based in country, like through and through. So, well, at least from what I'm assuming. So I'm excited to see how it turns out. I'm excited to see what it sounds like. I'm excited to see, yeah, I'm just excited for this experience. So let's get into it. Out of rambling, I guess the last thing I'll say is in terms of credits, I'm not gonna run through the gamut of people who, you know, who contributed to this album, because I feel it feels like there's so many people that, you know, help write and produce. So many people. I'll probably list them along the way as I'm doing my reaction, but so many people here, so I can't really list them all. But feature artists of note, definitely want to mention Dolly Parton, Miley Cyrus, and Post Malone. A lot of people that I would have never thought Beyonce would have worked with in her life. So I'm excited to see people here. And on top of that, we have a lot of, you know, current black country artists, which I think is so exciting. Like, you know, Shaboozy, Brittany Spencer, Raina Roberts, Tanner Adele, and Tiara Kennedy. We get, and Willie, you know, Willie Nelson too. And we also got Rumi Carter on a track. So I love that. Rumi said, I'm trying to get my Grammy too. You're like, you know what I'm saying? Like, so I love that. Linda Martell. I'm gonna do my full reaction to this album. It'll be on Patreon, so definitely go support my Patreon. If you haven't joined already, go join the community. My Patreon link is down below in the description. $3 a month. Definitely go join my Patreon. On my Patreon, I'll have my exclusive videos and my, you know, my longer reaction videos. I won't have my YouTube. It'll be on my Patreon. So the full reaction to this album will definitely be on my Patreon. I'll only put snippets on the YouTube version. So definitely go check out the full reaction on Patreon if you haven't joined already. Appreciate y'all. But all right, y'all, without further ado, here's my first reaction to Cowboy Carter. I'm so excited, y'all. Let's do it. Y'all ready? Let's go. Track one, American Requiem. Hold on. Yo, these vocals are ready. Beyonce, bro, these stacks, the power of these vocals, like, it's like giving like an operatic vibe. Wow, what a way to intro this project. Oh my God. There's a lot of talking going on while I sing my song. Okay.
Can you hear me?
I can.
I said, do you hear me?
I do, B. I do. Come on.
Look at them, look at them now. Look at them, look at them.
B said, look at them, look at them now. Okay. Shoot.
Look at them, look at them. A lot of chatter in here.
Uh-huh.
But let me make myself clear.
Okay.
Do you feel me?
Uh-huh. Yo, who is that in the back? Was that B with these screeches and scowls? I can tell she about to get into her bag with this. Like, she's really, I can tell she about to get into her country, like, just, like, raw, you know, like, homegrown vocal bag. Like, I'm excited. I feel like she's about to go really, really different in a really different bag on this album vocally. I'm excited for it. Man. Ooh. I love that. Can we stand for something? Now's the time to face the wind. I'm loving how this intro track feels like a declaration of like you with me or not, you standing with me or not. Like, I love how this feels like a unification, but not like on some like, oh, kumbaya shit, but like on some like, nah, America is, you know, our foundation is, we founded on some bullshit, but like, now's the time to like, you know, we trying to go to a different place now. Now it's time to figure it out. Like, you know, and I like how she's like talking about like her own career too. Like, she's like, you know, like some of these lyrics are alluding to like things she's felt and been through in her own career, but she's still making it global and relatable to every person. Talk about, like, you know, can we stand for something? Like, you know, I've been through some bullshit, you know, this country some bullshit, but like, can we get to a new place? Like, I love this as the intro for the album. I know we're gonna get into like some like party, like, you know, real honky tonk vibes maybe, but this feels really cool as like the intro. Like, it feels like a declaration. And even though musically I'm like kind of like thrown off by it, like, it feels like musically a little, this feels different than like anything she's ever done, but I'm still like, I'm with the vibe so far, you know. These instruments, man. Okay. Look at it. 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 Come on. But question, B, where are we looking at? Even. You talking about, look at that, look at it. What are we looking at? You feel? Can you let me know what we looking at? Oh, man. Okay. Yes. Amen. You gotta let love in. Right. Come on. Right. Yo, can we dissect that? I love that. She said they used to say I spoke two country when she started out with Destiny's Child and all that. I can see that. And then the rejection came. And they said I wasn't country enough. Woo! Can we talk about that? Oh, God, bro. The leaps and bounds that Black women especially always have to make for everybody else's insecurities and uncomfortableness. B said, when I came in, I spoke to country, and then the rejection came and I wasn't country enough. Like, imagine. I was always country, but when I was too country, I wasn't rocking with it. But then when I wanted to be my country self, I wasn't country enough for y'all. Like, that's crazy, but that's facts. And that's what she went through. Like, that's crazy. I love these lyrics, and it's a good reminder of if Beyonce, if one of the most beloved, talented people in the world feels like that and has gone through that, what do you think is happening with the everyday, let's talk about it, the everyday Black woman in all types of spaces, whether it's the corporate space, in the country, you know, globally, wherever it is, like, you know, this, like, come on, man. Right. Facts. Mm-hmm. These vocals, y'all. Woo! And then she gonna have these like natural, like, you know, fireplace, like, you know, nature, bird sounds in the back too. Like, come on, man. Like, it's the details for me, Beyonce. Like, the background vocals were going crazy. Like, not even the lead vocals. For me, it was like the backgrounds in the song, like just all the background work. And then, like, you know, at the end, we having like these like nature, you know, in the country, and, you know, fireplace, you know, not fireplace, you know, like a fire burning, birds chirping, like, it's the details for me, B. Wow. And that's just track one. Oh my God. Here we go. Whew. Track two, Blackbird, featuring Tanner, Adele, Britney Spencer, Tiara Kennedy, and Raina Roberts. And this is a cover of the classic Beatles song, Blackbird. I like that song a lot. All right, so let's see how they did it. I'm excited. And all these female black country artists and Beyonce, this is going to be a moment. I'm excited. Let's see how this goes. Oh, she sounds so good on this.
Fly.
Yes.
All your life.
Mm-hmm.
You were only waiting for this moment to arise.
Yes.
You were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Night.
Okay.
Learn to see all your life.
Yes. Yo, this album is going stupid vocally, bro. These background, fly. Oh, I can't tell if this is her or the other artist in the background, but man, these backgrounds are so crazy. Like, it's so intricate, but it's so powerful in the back. Oh my God. And then the lead vocal is everything. Like, she sounds so good on this. And I can't wait till the other artists come in as well. Well, I'm starting to feel like maybe they're not actually giving their own verses and maybe they're just in the background, which is fine, but I would have loved... So far, I would have loved for like them to actually have their own moment on the song, but it's feeling like because there's so many of them that they're only gonna be in the background, which is okay. But I would love them to got a little bit of a spotlight, but it is what it is. You know what's crazy? I don't know if the Beatles, I forgot who wrote it. I don't know if it was, Lennon? I guess Lennon and McCartney. So they both wrote it. I don't know if they wrote this song about a black woman or, you know, about a black person in general. I don't know. If Beatles fans, y'all let me know. But I'm assuming it wasn't about a black person. And I love how Beyonce is using these lyrics and this song to honor like herself and other, you know, black country artists, especially female black country artists. And these lyrics are just so like, almost like, you know, like a declaration to like keep going and to like, you know, stay grounded and keep going. And even though it's like a cover, the lyrics are so appropriate for like this moment of her collaborating with all these black female country artists. Like, and I love what the cover is implying. It's amazing. I love it. And I'm pretty sure like this is a life changing moment for all these women as well. So this is dope. Oh, who's this? Is this Tanner? I think this is Tanner.
Aww.
Yes.
Woo.
Yes. What a moment. Track 3, 16 Carriages. We already know the song. Go check them out reaction to this and Texas Hold'em as well. If you haven't already, go check them out. Track 4, Protector, featuring Rumi Carter. Excited for this. I feel like this is going to be a deep track. Let's go.
How can I be here? The world of mine, please.
Yes, Rumi. Rumi said, I want a lullaby. What's up?
And there I was, tangled up in marigold. We were. Yes. Humming low as the garden river flows while the August light becomes a golden evening. Yeah.
Mm.
Shine on your own. I will be your projector.
Oh, I love that. Even some days I know you're going to want to shine on your own. I will be your projector. Oh, I love that's such a deep line. This is so sweet. Oh. Now treat me. Yeah. Proud of who I am. Because you need me. Yeah. And I will lead you down that road if you lose your way. Yes. Wanna be a protector. Come on, B. Even though I know someday you're gonna shine on your own, I will be a projector. Oh, this is so cute. Even though I know someday you're gonna shine on your own, I will be a projector. Aww. There's a long line of hands carrying your name. Amen. Lifting you up so you will be raised. Hey, can we talk about it? Jay-Z's jeans really are strong. Mr. Sean Carter, your jeans are strong because the way Blue is looking more and more like her daddy every day. And Rumi, too. She looked just like her daddy. Like, yo. And so she said, I saw you in your father's gaze. Oh, I first saw you in your father's gaze. That's crazy. Facts. Like, her, the girls look just like Jay-Z. It's crazy, man. And the lyricism in this song, can we talk about it? This song is so sweet. It's so beautifully written. It's powerful. It feels like a mantra for the relationship between, you know, Beyonce and her children. And it feels like a mantra that everybody can use for, like, you know, people that they truly love and that they're lifting up in this life. This is such a beautiful track. Wow. And the fact that this is like only four, like this is like the fourth track on the album. Like, I thought something like this would have been like more like deeper on the album as we get later into it. Wow. This is going to be a ride, huh? Damn. I know someday you're going to shine on your own. I'll be a protector. Yes. I'm going to be a protector. Yes. Born to be a protector. And they hear children in the background. Love it. Track 5, My Rose. How many times have you let yourself get you down? Let yourself get you down, my dear. Now Beyonce about to make me cry. How many times have you let yourself down, my dear? And not with these vocals, with these harmonies. Oh, Beyonce, don't make me cry today. I don't got time. Because I have let myself down too many times. Too many times to count. And we all have. Oh, not Beyonce trying to pick me up from the ashes. I love it. Thank you, B. So many roses, but none to be picked with the thorns. So be fond of your flaws, dear. Oh my God, these lyrics. So many roses, but none to be picked without thorns. So fond of your flaws, dear. Wow. Like, word. Like, we, like, flaws and hardship is a part of life. We just gotta push through. We gotta live through it. And we gotta deal with it. These lyrics have been so beautiful throughout this project so far. I'm like, wow. Damn. Okay, let's keep going. Wow, that was like a beautiful interlude that I feel like was a perfect track to come right after Protector. Like, I feel like My Rose feels like an extension of Protector, but like with like a different arrangement. And like, you know, after we've solidified that like Beyonce is a protector for children, like, all right, let me give you some love now, because I know you're going to go through some shit in your life. Now, here's some love and, like, you know, here's some a reminder that, like, life is going to be hard, but, like, you got it and, like, you're good and you're loved. Man. Wow. Love it. Track 6, Smoke Hour with Willie Nelson. Come on, radio interlude. I'm assuming so far that these are all like, you know, classic, iconic black country songs from like, you know, the 20th century. I'm assuming like, you know, 60s, 50s, 60s, 70s. And I love his dedication. I know for a fact that these are all Black country artists that Beyonce is highlighting, and I love that. And I can't wait to dive into who she's highlighting in this interlude.
Welcome to the Smoke Hour on KNTRY Radio Texas. You know my name, no need to know yours. Now for this next tune, I want y'all to sit back, inhale, and go to that good place your mind likes to wander off to.
Okay.
And if you don't want to go, go find yourself a jukebox. Thank you.
Yo, that's crazy. Yo, can we talk about the fact that Beyonce really said, nah, I'm gonna make sure that, you know, the country crowd that is not rock with me, I'm gonna make sure that I don't think Beyonce cares so much that that a certain country crowd is cool with her or not. I don't think she's worried about that. But I love the fact that she got one of the most iconic country legends of our time, Willie Nelson, on her project to solidify that, like, all right, y'all might not rock with me, but like, I got one of the biggest to ever do it. And mind you, it's not like he's a white man. And, yo, he's, like, the king of y'all space. This man on my project, on my interlude, like, he over here, like, putting a stamp on what I'm doing. So that's the ultimate chess move right there. Like, I love that for Beyonce. Like, at the end of the day, I don't think Beyonce's, like, you know, looking for white validation. And that's a whole deep conversation that we don't need to get into right now. But I think it's so dope that she got people like Dolly Parton and Willie Nelson to be like, nah, like, I'm going to be a part of what you got going on. To, like, you know, some two of the biggest legends in country music, like, you know, that are white and not Black. And she's like, nah, like, I'm going to have them be part of my shit, and they're going to put their stamp on my shit. Like, not for, like, white approval, but, like, it's like, if I feel like with Dolly Parton and Willie Nelson being on this album in the small ways that they are, it's like, if people are not rocking with me coming into my country era, then that's y'all problem, because I got two of the biggest to do it and they rock with me. So it's like, if they rock with me, then that's your problem if you're not rocking with me. Ultimate chess move. I love that. Track 7, Texas Hold'em. We know, love this song. We're not gonna react to it, so we're gonna move on to the next track. But go check out my Texas Hold'em reaction if you haven't already. Appreciate y'all. Track 8, Bodyguard. And this was produced by Raphael Sadiq, so I'm excited for this. Shout out my guy Raphael. Here we go. Okay. Woo.
So sweet. I give you kisses in the back seat.
Okay.
I whisper secrets in the back
seat. Uh-huh.
You make me cry, you make me happy.
Love that. Sing. Come on. Talking about Betty Davis? Hey. I love the groove of this song. This song just feels good. Ah, honey, honey. This song feels so, like, it doesn't feel too rehearsed and too programmed. It feels so, like, natural. I don't know. It feels like she didn't put too much energy into recording this song. It just felt very real time, real instruments, genuine vibes, and just, you know, just homegrown vocals. Like, this track feels so refreshing. I love this. Okay.
Oh, honey, honey,
mm.
I could be your life
guard. Okay. Honey,
honey.
Come on. Woo!
In the mosh pit.
Hey, come on.
And I'll defend you in the gossip.
Okay. Right.
I like the way she's looking at you.
Oh, Beyonce's messy. She said, you know people like to start shit and pop shit. And I don't like the way she's looking at you. Yeah. Y'all know Beyonce is a hub bop at the end of the day. She knows she's a star. She knows she's a celebrity. But at the end of the day, Beyonce going, you know what I'm saying? Don't play with her, Beyonce. I love that. Right, better hold me back. Right. Come on. Love that arrangement. Love this.
Will you let me ride shotgun?
Oh, this is definitely a highlight so far. I love this. Come on. Woo! Oh, my good sis is singing on this track, bro. This almost feels like it could be like the cuff of this album. Like that song, when I first heard it, it was just hitting for me. And then, over time, it became a hit for the rest of the world, too. I could see this song being a highlight for a lot of people, for sure. I'm going to look out for Bodyguard. I can see Bodyguard being one of those ones, for sure. Okay.
Bodyguard.
Hey.
Be your Cavalier. Woo. Lifeguard.
Man, that track was so sweet but gutter at the same time. Perfect combination. Like, it's a sweet romantic track. I'm gonna hold you down. I got you, babe. But at the same time, like, nobody better play with you. And these people ain't shit out here. Like, yeah. That track was everything. Wow, I love that one. Okay. Track 9, Dolly P with Dolly Parton. It's a little interlude. Let's see that.
Hey, Miss Honeybee.
Right.
It's Dolly P.
Yo, that's iconic. Hey, Miss Honeybee. It's Dolly P. You know, do you guys understand how iconic it is for Dolly Parton to be a part of this album? Even if it's just this little interlude. I don't know if she's on Jolene, which is the next track. I'm assuming Jolene is just a cover, so I don't think Dolly Parton will be on that. But the fact that Dolly Parton is on this album interluding into Beyonce doing a cover of her song. That, you know how iconic this is, y'all? Y'all know how iconic this is? Like, for real. Like, y'all understand how iconic this is? Let me listen to the rest of this interlude. I mean, oh yeah, isn't this the interlude where everybody, I heard on Twitter that, like, Dolly P was talking about, like, some hussy, but, like, she had auburn hair or some shit like that. All right, let's listen. I'm excited.
You know that hussy with the good hair you sang about?
Yeah.
That reminded me of someone I knew back when.
Uh-huh.
Except she has flaming locks of auburn hair.
Right.
Bless your heart.
Right.
Just a hair of a different color.
Uh-huh.
But it hurts just the same.
Right. But it hurts just the same. Right. All these hoes out here, these hussies out here, taking our menses. I love this for Dolly Parton and Beyonce. Dolly P said, yeah, B, I got you. Let me hop on your, let me do a little interlude. I got you. Like, and then she talk about, yeah, you know that girl, Jolene? Yeah. Oh, that girl you talking about with the good hair? Man, I had one girl like that in my life too. Her name was Jolene, but she had auburn hair. Like, oh, this interlude is so iconic. It is hilarious and it is so iconic. I love that. I love this. Oh my God. Here we go. All right. Track 10, Jolene.
Jolene.
Okay, we're gonna put some hood up in it. Come on.
Jolene, 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 Jolene.
Sing, B.
I'm warning you, don't come for my man.
Right, hussy.
Jolene, 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 Jolene.
Come on. Uh-huh.
To come between a family and a happy man.
Mm.
We've been deep in love for 20 years. I raised that man, I raised his kids. I know my man better than he knows himself.
Come on.
You don't want this month to shoot your shot with someone.
Wait, because I don't remember the original Jolene like that. Is that an actual lyric in the original Jolene? But you don't want this smoke, so shoot your shot with someone else? Or is this like a remixed version? Because if it is, I love that. Because I thought this was like a straight through cover. But it feels like Beyonce like remixed this a little bit. I love that. She said, but you don't want the smoke, so shoot your shot with someone else. That's such a modern thing. It's such a Beyonce thing. I love that. That's so cool. All right, I just looked on Wikipedia and it said it's a cover, but Beyonce, like, you know, she changed some lyrics up for herself. I love how Beyonce's making it her own version. I love that. Let's go. This is fire.
You heard me.
Come on.
I know I'm a queen, Jolene.
Come on, I'm a queen,
Jolene.
I'm still a Creole Benji bitch from Louisiana. Oh my God. I love how Beyonce's making this like a black gutta version of it. Like, fire. What? God bless Dolly Parton. But we needed a hood version of Jolene, and Beyonce gave us one. Wow! I didn't even know we needed it until Beyonce gave us one. Amazing. Amazing. What? Wow.
There's a thousand girls in every room that act as desperate as you do. You a burglar and sang your tune.
Jolene.
Yo, that vocal was insane. Plant a seed. That vocal was insane. Plant a seed. Wow. Damn, B. Come on.
Stand by him, he could stand by me.
Wow, that was a new classic take on that iconic song. Wow, Beyonce really made that her own. She made it black. She made it gutter. She made it a vibe. Wow. But it still feels classic at the same time, you know? Wow, amazing. Shout out Beyonce and shout out Dolly Parton. Wow. Track 11, Daughter.
Your body laid out on these filthy floors. Your blood stains on my custom couture. Bathroom attendant let me right in. She was a big fan.
It feels like this is like a murder saga we getting on this track. Wow, okay. I didn't think we were getting like these type of vibes, but I'm here for it though, okay. Not Beyonce giving us like this, like, you know, cinematic Western, you know, the woman on the side was murdered story. Let's see how this goes. Wow.
I really try to stay cool, but your arrogance disturbed my solitude.
Beyonce, not you were a murderer.
Now I ripped your dress and you're all black and blue. Look what you made me do.
Not look what you made me do. Oh my God, Beyonce.
If you cross me, I'm just like my father. I am colder than Titanic water.
Yo, that's crazy. I'm colder than Titanic water. That's crazy, but facts.
Fantasies in my head. They ain't never been safe ones. I don't fellowship with these fake ones. From this marijuana smoke smell in my hair. Outfit too small to hide my scars. Feeling bottled up like bottle service bride.
How long can he hold his breath before his death? Yo, this is a whole like movie. This is a short film and a song. Like, wow. I don't think she's giving us a track on this album that felt like a whole like, you know, short films, like a really cinematic story. This is really cool. Damn, I'll be getting a murderer's row story on this album. Let's go. But this feels very country. Let's talk about it. You know what I'm saying? Oh, with opera vibes? Come on.
Mm.
I've been forgetting that Beyonce, when she really wants to, she can tap into her operatic bag crazy. She already kind of did on the intro a little bit too on American Requiem. But this song, yeah, she's really getting to it too. Like, I forgot what album that was, but she showed behind the scenes footage of her recording. And she was like playing around with her operatic range. And I was just like, yo, like, why does Beyonce do this more often? Like, obviously it makes sense because, you know, she does like, you know, especially on past albums, it was more like, you know, regular R&B, pop, you know. But man, like, I would love to for Beyonce to just like, even in live performances, like just play. I mean, she did it on the Renaissance tour a lot too, but I just wanted to show that operatic style more often because it's such a dope bag to get into that not a lot of singers and vocalists are able to do, like, especially like, you know, ones that are like in modern contemporary music. And I love that Beyonce can do it. So it's like, I want to hear it more, but this is such a vibe. I love this. This sounds crazy. Sing, baby! Oh, sing. My sister, woo! Sing me. Give it to us. Oh my God.
Let's travel to white chapels and sing hymns.
Uh-huh.
Sing a rosary, sing and sing glass symphonies. Cleanse me, Holy Trinity, from this marijuana smoke smell in my head. I'm the furthest thing from choir boys
and altars.
Double cross me, I'm just like my father.
Wow. Bro, that track felt like a movie. Wow. That production was insane. Those instruments were crazy. The operatic vibe in the middle with the Spanish part. Like, the story being told. Like, this was, it could be like a Quint. This song felt like a Beyonce version of like a Quentin Tarantino movie. And I love that. You know, like, this is Beyonce giving us like her Kill Bill vibes, but in song form. You know what I'm saying? If we got the visual for Daughter, imagine. Oh my God, that would be insane. That track was nuts. Wow. Track 12, Spaghetti, featuring Linda Martell and Shaboozey. And I know Swizz Beatz helped produce on this as well. So let's see how this sounds. I'm excited.
Genres are a funny little concept, aren't they?
Right.
Yes, they are.
Right. Come on, Swizz.
They have a simple definition that's easy to understand.
Right.
But in practice, well, some may feel confined.
I love this interlude and what Linda Martell is saying, because facts, I feel like this is literally what Beyonce is going through on this album. Like, genres are funny, right? Like, they help, you know, the average person figure things out. But at the end of the day, for those who are operating on a different level, bitch, genres don't mean nothing because we're trying to do it all. You know what I'm saying? And that confines us. And I literally, I said that before I even started the album. Like, so yeah, man, shout out to Linda Martell for that, this little interlude. Love it. Wow. Come on, Swizz. What we getting? We about to get some gutter shit. I already know it. Let's go. Come on. Hold on! What? Let's go! I ain't in no gang, but I got shooters and they bang, bang! Like, what is this? Hold on a second. I'm not ready for this. Hold on, I'm not ready for this. I ain't in no gang, but I got shooters and I bang, bang! Wait, what is happening right now? This is about to be a highlight. I can already feel it. Let's go. I might be wrong, but let's see. Hold on. Okay, let's go. Come on, Rose. Come on.
They call me the captain, the catwalk assassin. When they know what's snapping, and here come the yapping. All of this snitching and all of this bitching. Just a fishing expedition, dumb admission in the kitchen. Cooking up some chickens, extra leg, but I ain't even trying to kick it. Country, country, petty, petty, petty. All the same to me, plain James, spaghetti.
No. Hold on. This track is going too fast for me. It's going too fast. Hold on. Take it. The flow on this track is crazy. I low-key feel like I'm not in the pocket of it yet, but I feel like once I hear it a few times, I'll get into it. But the pocket is like, I'm trying to catch the pocket. And maybe this is on me, not on Beyonce. This is on me. I'm trying to catch the pocket. It's fire so far, but I'm like, yo, hold on. But yo, shout out to Swizz Beatz for like bringing like a little bit of hip hop flair into this album. I feel like we've been missing that, which is fine. But I like that, you know, Beyonce and Swizz said we're gonna bring a little ratchet hip hop energy into this album a little bit with this track so far. And this is crazy. But let's get into it. I feel like I need to run this back when I finish it. But this flow was insane. But I feel like I need to catch it because it's just like, whoa, I didn't expect this. This is cool though. I ain't no regular saying, and I come get everything that you came for. Right, bro. Facts. Yo, this flow. Yo, not Beyonce on her rap shit on this track. I love it. I didn't think we were going to get like a rap track on the album, but I love that we did. And it still fits. Like, wow. And I bang, bang. And one thing I like about this track, it really feels throwback with the sound. Like, this feels like an old school Swizz Beatz Timbaland beat. Like, it feels like a beat from like the like late 90s, early 2000s. It feels like one of those beats, but like in this like really cool gutter way. With like this like kind of R&B and country influence in there a little bit. It's really cool. This Shaboozy. Okay, let me go slow it down for the second half of the track. Okay. Yo, Beyonce is the person that really put me onto Shaboozy, even though I think I've heard his name before, but obviously she's the one that's really putting us onto a lot of us onto him. And I gotta say, I love this man's tone. I think I've seen a recent Colors that he did, and that Colors show, I was like, yo, this man's tone is so fire. Like, I love his tone. It's country, but it feels like it can fit in different spaces. But you like his tone, his voice is so country. But it's also like, you know, it can be in other spaces. But I just love the sound of his voice. And he sounds good on this too. Like, wow. Right. Right. Come on. Right. I love that. Don't matter the charges, we ain't telling the truth. Come on. We take it to the grave with us, you know what I'm saying? That track felt all over the place, you know, conceptually and musically. But I feel like once I really live with it, I'm gonna get my life. But our first listen, it was a vibe, but I was like, whoa, hold on, wait, this is a lot. You feel me? But I feel like once I really get into it, I'm gonna really appreciate it a lot more. But I kind of wished it was separated into like two different tracks, because it feels like two different tracks. Like the first half is a whole different vibe than the last part of it. But maybe I'll appreciate that they melted it together. But I gotta live with it. That was probably like the most hype track we've got on the album so far, besides maybe Bodyguard. So that was interesting. Track 13, Alligator Tears. Oh. This almost feels like a cousin to 16 Carriages musically so far, which I love. I think the vocal style she chose on this song is interesting. It's like this like slur, drawn out vibe. It's not like, I'm not loving it so far, but I also feel like it's probably going to fit the vibe of the song. So it might be a great choice stylistically. But at first listen, I'm like not loving it, but I think I will appreciate how it fits with the theme of the song with more listens. But let me finish it too. But this is interesting. But kind of throw me off a little bit, but it's interesting. This is country as hell though, so I appreciate it.
Something about those tears of yours. How does it feel to be adored?
I know this might sound random, but I feel like if Olivia Rodrigo went into country, I feel like this is the exact type of song she would make. Let me know if y'all feel me. For all my Olivia Rodrigo fans out there, I feel like if she made a country song, I feel like this is a song that would be right in her album. Like from the way it's being sung to the lyrics to the style of it, this gives me Olivia Rodrigo, but make it country. Like, let me know if y'all feel me on that. But so I love it, but it took me a while to get into it, but it's interesting. I love the lyrics because I feel like a lot of people can relate to this. Like, being with somebody that you just can't help but to, you know, fine, I'll bend over and, you know, I'll be at your whim. I'll be at your beck and call because I love you so much. Like, how does it feel to just, you know, have my world in your hands? How does it feel? Like, where? Like, a lot of people can relate to this. Oh, I love. Did y'all hear that too? Love that. That was so intricate, but that was fire. I gotta hear that again. Too. That was fire. Love that. Our first listen, this might not be one of my favorites off the album. It might not be a highlight for me, but this so far feels like one of the most truest country songs, and I really do appreciate the storytelling in this track. It might be one of my favorite tracks in terms of the storytelling and the arrangement, even if it's not to me the most exciting musically, but also feels the most authentically country so far. So I definitely gotta give it credit for that. So interesting song for sure. Really interesting lyrics. And the arrangement is so, like, it's kind of muted compared to the rest of the album, but I feel like it fits the somber vibe of what it's talking about. So it's interesting. Ah! Oh, I love that. Love that. Woo! Wow, all those vocal stacks at the end, that was crazy. Love it. Bananas. One thing about this album, y'all, Beyonce is not playing vocally. Every second of these songs is like she's going crazy with the vocals, like just embedding so many small details in there. I'm just like, bruh. You can tell she took her time to really craft these songs. You can tell she was working on these songs for years because, like, the details in these songs is crazy. Wow. Track 14, Smoke Hour 2 with Willie Nelson. Second interlude for the album. Let's go.
You tuned into KNTRY Radio Texas, home of the real deal. If there's one thing you can take away from our set today, let it be this.
Okay, what's up? What is it?
Sometimes you don't know what you like until someone you trust turns you on to some real good shit.
Uh-huh.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why I'm here.
Uh-huh.
Up next on the Smoke Hour is Just for Fun by Beyoncé. You're welcome.
Oh, I love that. That's fire. Okay, another cute interlude. Love that. Shout out Willie Nelson. Love the little message in there too. Facts. Track 15, Just for Fun, featuring Willie Jones. One of my other favorite, you know, current black country artists out there, shout out Willie Jones. I'm excited to hear this. Let's go.
I'm going all out just for fun. I am the man I know.
Okay.
Time moves quickly and so do I, so do I. So I'll say my goodbye.
Ooh, hold on, that low. So I'll say my goodbye. So I'll say my. Ooh, I love that. That low note was fire. Ooh, so I'll. Love that.
Kills everything. I don't need anything. Hallelujah.
Musically, this is a gorgeous track so far. Gorgeous. Yo, I can't pick up what that instrument is in the background, but I'm hearing it. That little click thing. I feel like I know that instrument, but am I tripping? What is that? It's not a cowbell, but it's like a something like a tick. I know what it is, but I can't remember the name. But love that it's here. Like, it's dope. Come on, Willie. Love his tone, come on.
From the cowboys and clovis in a rodeo circus. Under the surface.
That's the R&B Beyonce coming out. It's under the surface. Love that. That's so dope.
I don't need anything. Hallelujah.
Come on. So she said, I pray to her. I pray to her. I'm so fascinated by that line. I wonder if she's trying to say that, you know, Jesus is a woman, God is a woman, or if this means something else, or of her is like somebody else. I don't know if I haven't picked up on what that means, but I think it's interesting. Hallelujah, I pray to her. I mean, God is a woman. I'm here for that. Why not? Come on. Yeah, this is a really interesting song that I think I really need to like get into. I need to run it back more to really get into it lyrically and what it's really getting at. But musically, I love it. And I love the intention and the pacing and the musicality of it. And I need to get into the story that's really telling. But really beautiful track so far.
I'll fall fast asleep tonight. To get to this,
come on.
Get used to it.
Come on.
'Cause time heals everything. I don't need anything. Hallelujah.
Amen. Man, wow. All right, I've been waiting to hear this one. Track 16, Two Most Wanted, featuring Miley Cyrus. I'm excited to hear this one. Let's go. Okay, it's a ballad? Oh, I thought it was going to be an up-tempo. I'm not going to hold you, but okay, let's go. This could be dope. Let's see, okay.
All
right.
Didn't know what I want till I saw your face. Say goodbye to the old me. Came out and knew I didn't give no warning. Pedal so heavy like a two most wanted. And I don't know what you're doing tonight.
Hold on, that I could hear that again. That was so beautiful. Their voices blended so well right there.
Two most wanted. And I don't
know. I love that.
You're doing tonight.
Ooh.
But I.
Ooh.
But I'll be a shotgun rider till the day I die.
Wow.
Smoke out the window, flying down the 405.
Come on.
I'll be a backseat baby, driving you crazy anytime you like. Oh, I'll be your shotgun rider till the day I die.
Wait, y'all, I'm actually shocked by how well their voices blend together. I would have never thought about a Beyonce and Miley Cyrus collaboration ever in my life. Not because, you know, I'm like against it, but I just would have never thought about that. And I love that apparently Beyonce grabbed Miley, you know, after the Grammys this year and was like, yo, come hop on this album. And wow, their voices sound so good together. Like, I'm actually shocked. But I shouldn't be because they're both amazing in their own regards. A lot of people don't know, but I rock with Miley Cyrus a long way. I don't know why a lot of black people don't give Miley Cyrus her things, because at the end of the day, you know, that whole bangers era, I get it. But at the end of the day, Miley Cyrus, the music is always hitting, and that voice of hers and her performance ability, especially, you know, her performance at the Grammys this year, like, when Miley Cyrus really wants to, like, she can tap into a bag that is just so special vocally. You know, musically, like, she really just really be in her bag sometimes. I feel like a lot of people don't really give her things because, you know, child star, you know, she went through like all this, you know, all these things throughout the years with like bangers era, and she went through all this nonsense. But it's like, at the end of the day, like, in her grown woman era now, like, you know, she's making amazing music and her voice is crazy. So shout out to Beyonce for giving Miley this moment, and she stepped up to the plate because this is fire. Like, they sound great together, and this track is a vibe. What?
Making waves in the wind with my empty hand.
Come on.
My other hand on you.
All right.
Been a while since I haven't tried to pull away. But it's time for something new. Came out of nowhere, didn't give no warning. Felt so heavy like the two most wanted. And I don't know what you're doing tonight.
Right.
But I'll be your shotgun rider till the day I die.
Come on. Come on.
I'll be your backseat, baby. Driving you crazy anytime you like. Whoa, I'll be your shotgun rider till the day I die. Till the day I die.
Wow. I'm sorry. This is giving a little bit of gospel too. I ain't gonna hold you. Is it just me? This is giving a gospel track. Come on. I don't know. This is even gospel vibes, man. This is this is everything. I'm sorry. What? Yes. Right.
I'll be your shotgun rider till the day I die. Time is passing by. I'll be your backseat, baby.
Driving you crazy.
Anytime you like.
Woo!
I'll be your shotgun rider till the day I die.
Sing, Miley! B, sing. Oh, bitch. I'll be a shotgun rider till the day I die. This song feels classic. It feels like an instant classic. That was my first listen of the song. And this song already feels like a generational classic. I'm not even gonna hold you. Like, I might be bugging, but it feels like an instant classic for our generation. Iconic link up, iconic song. Like, I feel like this song might win a Grammy next year. Like, this might win like the country duo performance Grammy because, like, what? that vocal. The lyrics, the arrangement, that was so fire. Oh, that was definitely a highlight for me so far as well. I love that. Miley, you did that. Come on. Beyonce called you, say, I got you, boo. What? Wow, that was so fire. Wow, that was great. Man, I'm sorry. I'm still like recovering from that. Especially the climax at the end with their vocals, bro. That was nuts. Wow. Yes, God. Yes, God. My God today. And speaking of collaborations that I would have never thought I would have seen Beyonce do with other younger white artists from our time, track 17, Levi's Jeans with Post Malone. I cannot wait to see how this sounds. I would have never thought Beyonce would link with Post Malone. Like, they're probably cool behind the scenes, but I just feel like musically they're in different worlds. But if anything, this is the one project where I feel like they both could have came together. So I'm actually glad it happened. And this is a link up I'm excited to hear. Let's see how this sounds. Let's go. I feel like this is about to be fire. Okay. Boom. 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 Oh, this feels good already. Come on.
You call me pretty little thing.
Okay.
I love to turn them on.
Yes.
Why I let you be my Levi's.
Right. So you can hug that ass all day long. I love this.
Come be a sexy little thing.
Okay.
Snap a picture, bring it on.
Come on.
Oh, you wish you were my Levi's jeans. When it's popping out your phone.
Okay.
Down to the bone.
Baby, you play too much. Sending me super shots. Looking super hot. I got the perfect clothes. I'm a broken animal.
Saddle up. I love this. Wow. Okay. Okay. This is a sexy track. This is a cute track, man. I love it. Beyonce said, I like to turn this man on. He can be my Levi's jeans. Wow. Okay. This is cute. Woo. Come on, pose. Oh, this is everything. Love this. I love how Post is keeping his DNA intact on this verse. Like, it's very much given a country essence with the vocal and with the music itself, but he's still bringing like this like rap flow to the verse and like, you know, a rap energy with the arrangement in a way, which is him. Like, Post Malone is very much like, you know, he's rap, but he still knows how to like be like alternative and country and, you know, like, and pop when he needs to be. He's a very good, you know, chameleon musically. But, you know, I love how this feature, for anybody who's like not, he's one of the biggest artists of our time. But for some, for example, like, if someone were to be introduced to Post Malone with this song and with this collaboration, I love how this is like very much, like, he's not changing for Beyonce. Like, this is very much his bag. Like, you know, he's giving you like a rap cadence with the flow, but he's singing and it's pop and it's country, but he has this like rap cadence. It's very much Post. I love it. He sounds so good on it. Come on, Post. Come on. Come on. Ooh. Quiet like you. Love that. Come on. Come on. Come on. Hey. Sounds a vibe. Come on. Woo. Hey, you're my renaissance. Come on, call back to renaissance. Love it. Wow. Oh, this guitar at the end, that was fire. That was fire. Yo, Beyonce and Post sound so good together. That's a collaboration I would never thought. I wouldn't even know how they would sound together, but they sounded so good together. Damn, yo, Beyonce, you ate with these collaboration choices. Miley Cyrus and then going to Post Malone, and both of these songs sound fire. This is such a cute, like, romantic bop. Like, it was such a chill bop. I love, like, the rhythm of it. It had, like, this, like, it was really chill, but it had this, like, really cool, like, force about it, you know? That was a cute little bop. And then the vocals were going crazy towards the end, especially. That feels like another classic song. Like, wow. And Levi Jeans was produced by The Dream. So shout out to The Dream. You ate that production, bro. It sounds so good. Track 18, Flamenco. Come on with the flamenco sound in there. Really interesting vocals. I love that. I hope that you notice. Love that.
I wish that I know you love me
you under. Woo! I hope that God knows that I'm in need of help right now.
Beyonce, these vocals. Come on. Okay.
Till the deed is done. Oh, I hope they know once it's over. And say what you love, so hold me closer. Till it is gone. Right about now.
Wow, that was a really powerful interlude. And I really need to run it back lyrically, but I was loving the lyrics I was hearing, and that was really, I love how it had, like, you know, that flamenco sound in there embedded. It was really cool. Subtle, but, like, you could hear it. And that was a really, I actually like that wasn't a full song. It felt like a really cool statement as, like a shorter interlude. Really cool. Okay. Track 19, The Linda Martell Show. Can't wait to hear this interlude. Shout out to Linda Martell.
Okay, thank you so very much. Ladies and gentlemen, This particular tune stretches across a range of genres.
Okay.
And that's what makes it a unique listening experience.
Okay.
Yes, indeed.
Uh-huh.
It's called Yaya.
Amen. All right. And it goes to the next track, Yaya. Track 20, Yaya. Oh, is that the boots are made, these boots are made for walking? Is that what I hear? Come on. And shout out to Jessica Simpson's version. Really random, but I've actually been playing Jessica Simpson's version a lot lately. I love that song. I love her cover of These Boots Make Me Walk In from the Dukes of Hazzard soundtrack back in 05. That was a bop. Shout out to Jimmy Jam and Tellus for producing that. Love that song. I've been playing that a lot recently. Really random, but I guess I'm in my country background. I don't know why, but shout out to Jessica Simpson's version. And I feel like I'm hearing These Boots Make Me Walk In. So this is cool. Let's see what we got. I'm excited for this track. Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Those petty ones can fuck with me.
Uh-huh.
Cause I'm a clever girl. We snapping.
Okay.
Pretty please. We wanna welcome you to the Beyonce Cowboy Carter Act 2. In a rodeo chilling circuit.
Okay. Yo, she said, we're gonna make it do what it do. Yeah, yeah. Yo, this track is interesting so far. I love this. Okay.
We clapping.
Okay. Yeah, 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 yeah. B-E-Y-I-N-C-E, yeah. Beyonce, okay. Yo, this is fire. Oh my God, I'm trying to keep up with this track. Oh my God. Uh-huh. Whole lot of red in that white and blue. Can we talk about it? Bro, okay. History can't be erased, right? Yeah, yeah. Woo! Right. Come on. Shit. Yeah, yeah. Come on. Can't watch the news nowadays. Facts. Hey. Okay. Slow it down.
Fuck
it. We just. Okay, we're twerking. Hey. Okay. Now I got your spurs barking. Yeah, yeah. Come on. Oh, this is a highlight for sure. What? Good God. La 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 la. Hey. One once, oh my God, bro. I feel like this track is taking me through a journey of like different things she's talking about, emotions, vibes. Now she on her freak shit. She's talking about, listen, we gonna put the babies to bed. We gonna sweat out these sheets. We gonna be up all night. Now you don't wanna leave. Like, bro, this track is so, it's like this one big, like, gumbo pot of like just vibes. Like, and I love it. It's so interesting. Come on!
To New York City.
Come on. Oh, this is so country.
Shake my ass.
That's all we wanna do. Have a black right. Come on, we vibrating. Come on. Woo! Come on, B. That track was crazy. That felt like another highlight that I don't know if it'll be a hit, but that felt like another song is going to be a fan favorite for sure. I feel like that's going to be a fan favorite of this album. That track was just a movement, like 4.5 minutes, but it felt like a 2-minute song because it was just, you know, like that track was a journey. Like, and Linda Martell said this track is a whole different bunch of vibes and genres, but you're going to love it. So let's get into it. And did, you know what I'm saying? Wow. Okay. That was an experience, and I can't wait to run that back again. You feel me? Wow. Track 21, Oh Louisiana. This is produced by The Dream. It looks like it's a short interlude. Oh, I think they said this is like a cover or interpolates Oh Louisiana by Chuck Berry. So, okay, this is cool. Let's hear it. Shout out Chuck Berry. And shout out Miss Knowles, Miss Tina Knowles. Mama Louisiana. You feel me? Okay. That was cute. I don't know if I needed it on the album, but I definitely appreciate, like, you know, I guess, you know, trying to pay homage to, you know, Louisiana and Chuck Berry and her mama. I don't know if I needed it, but it was cute as a little interlude. It was cute. Track 22, Desert Eagle. Ooh, the instruments already? Ooh, that bass. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm still trying to get, I'm not even in the lyrics yet. I'm still trying to get over that bass. Hold on. Let me run it back again. Woo! Come on. Ooh. This feels good. Ooh. Come on. Come on. Do-si-do and it get creamy in the middle, yeah. Beyonce. If y'all don't know, Beyonce was a freak by now. If y'all don't know her and Jay-Z be fucking by now, then where you been? Do-si-do and it get creamy in the middle, yeah. Love this. One bite in the box is yours. Wow. I feel like this is going to transition to a hype, more like a dance track. I'm excited. Next track is track 23, Riverdance, produced by The Dream. Let's go. I'm excited for this one. Here we go.
Dance.
Come on.
Dance.
Well, I okay, I got you, B. I'ma dance. Damn, I got you. Damn.
Bounce on that shit, dang.
Hold on.
Bounce on that shit, dang.
Hold on.
Bounce on that shit, no hands. Bounce on that shit, dang.
Okay.
Bounce on
that shit. No hands, I got you. Okay. Ooh, this sounds so interesting.
Ooh.
Okay. Hold on, I'm sorry. This, I can't tell if that's a banjo. I'm assuming it's a banjo. That's this banjo that's going crazy in the background is such a vibe, and this almost feels like a cousin to something that could have been on Renaissance, but in a country way, which I love. And I'm not even a minute in, and I already feel like this is like one of my favorite songs musically on the album. And I also love the feeling it's giving me. I don't even like, yeah, this feels like a vibe already. Like, I'm excited for this. This show. Shout out to The Dream, man. The Dream already has some of my favorite songs in the album already. Between this and what was it? Was it Yaya that he did too? I can't remember. But yeah, this is a vibe. Wow, hold on. Woo! I love this. Come on.
The barrel of my gun. Yes, I shot you down. He cried the day he realized that lies were hidden in my kisses. Bounce on the shit.
Dance. I love how this is like it's a dance track, but I feel like it's trying to tell a story in between, like talking about dancing. Interesting.
Hold in my arms, he was my mess, my ball of string. I would give him everything, my thunderstorm and second chances. Bounce on the shit.
Wow. Yeah, this feels so tribal. No one is called River Dance. It feels tribal. Pain. Come on. Come on.
Sunday night, bounce on the shit, dance,
ayy.
Bounce on the shit, dance. Bounce on the shit, dance. Bounce on the shit, now.
Hands.
Wrap me around your little finger, wrap me around your wedding ring. Hey. Bounce on the shit, dance. Bounce on the shit, dance.
I love this track.
Bounce on the shit, no.
Hands. Woo! This banjo's going crazy. I love this banjo. Yo, I love that line. Staring at the barrel of his gun. Yes, he shot me down. I died, but then I came back straight to life, but never to my senses. That is such a fly line. Wow, I love that.
Come into my senses.
Woo!
Again, Saturday and Sunday
night. Bounce on that shit, dance. Bounce on that shit, dance. Bounce on that shit, dance. Bounce on that shit, dance.
Hey!
Wow. Your smile was cold, your fade was fresh. I love how she's making it black. Come on, this is a country album. We're gonna make it black. We're gonna make it gutter. Come on, your fade was fresh. Amen. You feel me? The fade was fresh. You feel me? Amen. Come on. Oh, this song's a vibe. These vocals. These backgrounds. Oh, this is definitely a fave so far. I love this one.
Bounce on the shit, dance. Bounce on the shit, dance. Hands.
Wow. That track was a vibe, but I can't wait to run that back. That banjo, that beat, the vocals, the arrangement, that felt like, I don't even know. That track felt light, but it felt intentional at the same time. Like, it felt like one of the most, like, fun, carefree tracks in the album, but still talk about some shit. And really, in my opinion, one of the most musically powerful tracks on the album so far. I love that one. Wow, that was bounce on that shit, dance. Bounce on that shit, no hands. Oh yeah, and Ray helped write that one. Shout out to my girl Ray on helping write Riverdance. Love that for her. Like, yo, shout out Ray. Shout out to my girl Ray, who won like 6 awards at the Brit Awards this year. Love that for her. Deserved Grammy nominations, but y'all played in her fucking face. But okay, Academy, whatever. We'll keep it moving. But yeah, shout out to Ray for this writing credit, for this amazing vibe of a track. I love, yo, Ray, thank you for Riverdance. Thank you for helping write Riverdance. Amazing song. I can't wait to see the world really get their life to the song, because it's everything. God damn. Track 24, Two Hands to Heaven. And this is produced in part by Soundwave. Shout out to Soundwave on this track. Let's go. Okay. Two hands to heaven.
God only knows why, though.
This is interesting because so far I feel like this is gonna have a very country feel with the lyrics, but so far musically this sounds like more of like an alternative track, which is interesting.
My whiskey up high,
oh. I love these lyrics. Ooh, lost virgins with broken wings that will regrow. Ooh, these lyrics throughout these songs so far are so cinematic, and I can visualize this song. It's so well written. Wow. Love that. She said, I will carry on. Love that. Love that.
I fit over these hips. Ooh. You grip my grind. And taste this wine. I'ma taste what's mine. I'ma take what's mine. Wonder ooh. Whatever, wherever. Wherever you wanna go, that's fine with me. I'll never stop you.
I love her vocals in this part. That's fine with me. I love her vocals in this part. They're so dope. Oh.
Stop me.
Right.
I'm so glad that this love is blinding.
Yes.
And all I see is everything. You're cold, yeah. I wanna get up to walk, I wanna feel weak, yeah. Stay where you
Bro, this feels like, I want to say this feels like the Virgo's groove of this album. Like the longest track that just feels like an odyssey of a song. It's a journey. Like, it feels so vividly cinematic. You know, this feels like the Virgo's groove of this album. This is a vibe. And this vocal that she just did, let me hear it again. What? She went off. Hold on. Woo, Welcome with Mars. Sing, B. Come on. Come on. Woof. Love that. Track 25, Tyrant. And this is probably produced by D.A. Got That Dope. I think besides Swizz Beatz, I think D.A. Got That Dope is the only other like hip-hop producer on this album. I think, I want to say.
Cowboy Carter, time to strike a match and light up this juke joint.
Come on. One. Was that Dolly Parton? Oh yeah, this is, my bad, this is featuring Dolly Parton. Let's go. Okay. Giddy up. Come on. D.A. got that. Come on. D.A. got that. Don't say, if you want a country beat, I got you, sis. Let's go. And he gave it to her. This is fire. I love this. Hold on. Hey. In the moonlight. Hey. Yo, how was Dolly Parton gonna come in on this? Or was she just in the beginning with the interlude? Because if Dolly Parton is gonna be on this, like this part right here, I can't wait to hear this. Let's see, but this is fire so far. Oh? Huh? Okay. Right. Come on.
I'm such a tyrant.
Okay. Oh, this part right here, especially with Haunting, this gave me Haunted, you know, but I might be tripping, but this is giving me Haunted vibes from self-titled. You know what I'm saying? Got that eerie vibe to it. This song's so interesting musically. Oh? Huh? Come on. Giddy up. Hey, hi. Come on. Okay. Woo. I love how this feels like a Negro spiritual with the beat and with the arrangement, but it still has a country essence with the lyricism, with the arrangement, you know, with the some parts of the music. Like, it feels, it's country, but it got that, like, got that bounce, it got that Negro spiritual, like that, you know, that cookout classic anthem to it in a way, you know what I'm saying? Love this. Woo! Hey.
I am such a tyrant.
Hey. Giddy up, giddy up. Hey, okay. Wow. Yo, that was definitely the highlight for me. Musically, like, yeah, that one definitely perked my ear up a lot. Damn, that was cool. Track 26, Sweet Honey Buckin', featuring Shaboozy and produced by Pharrell. So I'm excited for this. Let's see what we got. Hey, y'all. Now we got a little Jersey Club vibe in here. This album is so interesting. It has so many different elements in here, even though, like, you know, the foundation is country. But I want to say this song is going to be having, like, a Jersey Club vibe in there, which is really interesting. Let's see how they did this. But it's, like, a ballad at the same time. This is interesting. Come on, Shaboozy. Right. Yeah, I love it. He said, and the bag, the only thing getting lassoed. I love that. It's facts. And the bag, the only thing getting lassoed. Give me the bag. You feel me? Come on. This feels like a homecoming song for Beyonce, and I love that for her. She said, you know, she said Jiffy. Well, she said Jiffy cornbread, booty cornfed. Come on. Beyonce, I'm coming home. And this is the only song I play when I'm coming home. Amen. You are the superstar. Everybody's got no new cars. Hey. Wow. Hey. Yo, this song is so interesting. It's like a Jersey Club song, but it's a ballad at the same time. But it's country. Like, this is so cool. This is interesting. Wow. Pharrell, the genius that you are. Now we got a little, like, you know, traditional soul vibe in there. Okay. Wow, this is so interesting. Yo, for real, you're such a weirdo. But I love it. This almost feels like a cousin to Yaya in terms of the fact that it's like a million songs in one, in a way. This is really interesting. It's cool.
Bucking.
Okay.
Look at that horse.
Yo, Beyonce is not serious. Look at that horse. Horses. Beyonce is not serious. Look at that horse.
Bucky.
Uh huh. Wait, I just realized I think this might actually be three separate tracks in one. We have Sweet and then Honey and then Buckin. So now we're in Buckin. She said, AOTY, I ain't win. Bruh, album of the year, I ain't win. I ain't stuttin' about them. Take that shit on the chin. Come back and fuck up the pen. Woo! Let's talk about it, Beyonce. Word. Because at the end of the day, Beyonce was going to always be straight without an album of the year win. She deserved it. She been deserved. But she's still gonna always be her, and she's gonna still always have her artistry at the end of the day. I ain't win, fuck it. Take that shit on the chin, and I come back and I fuck him up again. Period. Oh, Lord, yes, God. Like, I love how she's just not pressed. She's like, all right, I ain't win that shit. I deserved it, but I ain't win it, but fuck it. I'm gonna come back and I'm gonna come harder and give the world what it needs. And she does, and did. Come on, man. Crazy.
Ain't no top filler with on my skin. Ooh. Snakes on the dam. They hiss and don't listen to them. They bite every once and again, but it gets stomped on when we fucking.
Not they bite every once and again. Beyonce, you talking crazy on this song, but everything is facts.
Bucking. Like a mechanical. Ooh, bucking. Whoa. Bucking.
This part right here feels like a classic early 2000s Pharrell, you know, Neptune's production. This almost sounds like Senorita by JT. This feels like a more country version of Senorita. Like, you know, The cool, the guitar sounds like Senorita, but like more like Beyonce country. It's really cool. Farce. Hey. I love that. Love that. Hey. Bucket. Oh. Bucket. Mechanical bull. I love how that felt like a hood, like gutter country bop, like bucking. Bucking like a mechanical bull. Bucking. Whoa. That was so interesting. Shaboozy kind of, you know, he ate a little bit on Sweet and Honey, I think. I think Bucket was my favorite part of that song. That was definitely like a three-parter. I think Buck was my favorite part of the song. But Sweet was vibe, Honey. Like, everything was a vibe. But, man, that was really interesting. I loved her getting a shit off about the Grammys. You know, people biting off of her. Like, I love that she was talking her shit on Bucking. Because, word. Like, all right, y'all. Last track. Track 27. Amen.
Mercy on me, baby. Have mercy on me. Mercy.
Hold on. Really interesting line. The statues they made were beautiful, but they were lies of stone. They were lies of stone. Wow. That's a powerful line, y'all, and it's facts. Wow. Yeah, man. Sing, babe.
Mercy, have mercy on me.
Oh my God, I love she's tying it back to the intro. I love that. Wow. A loop again. She did the same thing with Renaissance too. Like the outro will lead right back into the vibes of the intro. That's crazy. American Requiem, them old ideas are buried. Oh my God. And I love how she just said, we'll be the ones that purify our father's sins. Word. That's so real. Because listen, we gotta be the generation that cleans up all the bullshit. And it's unfortunate, but it is what it is. But that's real. Wow.
That purify our father's sins.
Love this. Come on, intro. Wow. Yeah, I love how the end of Amen is literally like leading right back into American Requiem. And I love how she said in the intro and in this and the last song, them old ideas are buried here. Word, like, I love how Beyonce's like claiming a new way of living, a new way of thinking for this new generation moving forward. Like, all these old ideas gotta go. They're buried in the South. They're buried, like, moving forward in a new way. Still keeping the best of country, still keeping the best of our humanity, but moving forward in a new way. Love that, man. Great way to start and end this album off. Wow. All right, y'all. That was my first reaction and my first listen of this album. What a ride. What a journey that was. This is a long album, and I'm tired, but I definitely got my life, and I loved so much of what I heard. So, yeah, man, let me live with the project for a couple of days, and let me listen to it a couple more times and get into it. And I will come back with my final review, which will be coming up right now. All right, y'all. So let's get to my overall review of this album. I've lived with the album for several days now. I've heard it several times. So I think first things first, I will say that while I don't think this album as of right now is in my personal, like, I don't think it's my personal favorite album by Beyonce the way I think a lot of people are claiming it to be. And if that is for you, cool. I love that for you. But to me, I don't think out of all of her music so far, I don't think this album is my personal favorite of hers. Musically, I think that title might be a battle between Renaissance and Four in terms of like my personal favorite Beyonce album. And you might even, I might even lump B-Day in there. I might even lump, you know, Lemonade in there. Love the debut too, you know. But yeah, I think my personal favorite albums are still like Renaissance and Four. I feel like those albums are kind of fighting off my favorite Beyonce albums. But while I don't think this is my favorite Beyonce album as a whole, I definitely think it's her most experimental, it's her most genre bending and genre defying, which we have to give kudos for. And I think to me, it might be her best album so far, quality wise. I think as an experience, you know, as a musical listening experience, as a body of work, as a project, you know, musically, but really just in terms of the quality of the production, the vocal work, the quality of how everything came together, the quality of, you know, just her taking so many, you know, at so many bold, you know, attempts at, you know, different genres and just these really unique songs that are just like out of, you know, just out of this world. I think this might be her best album in terms of, you know, just its overall quality and just with how bold she was with, again, like, you know, the experimenting with genres, the collaborations, all the vocal work and production work that went into this album and just the storytelling, the way it was put together. It might be her most sophisticated and most mature album and really one of her most well-executed albums to date. And let me know if y'all feel me on this. I really feel like Cowboy Carter, to me, feels like the country cousin to Self-Titled. You know, so when I say that, I mean like, you know, Self-Titled to me also signaled like, you know, the beginning of a new era in her career with leveled up, you know, execution of, you know, just promotional and, you know, just ideas and just the musicality. I feel like that album was a turning point in her career back then at that time, you know, with the visual album and just the way, you know, the way it sounded was the most expansive album at that time. And I really feel like that was like a turning point in her career. And I feel like this to me feels like a cousin to that. You know, now she's in her 40s, we're in the 2020s, and this is like her first full-length, you know, album that's really mostly country. This feels like a turning point in her career where she's leveling up again in a way that we've never seen and witnessed before from her. And I really feel like this will be an album that we'll look back on as a major shift in her career in terms of just when things expanded, things went up a level, and she really just showed us a different and a deeper level of her genius. And I'm looking forward to, you know, hopefully when that includes the tour and other things that'll come with this album, that'll definitely manifest. But I really feel like, to me, this album feels like the country twin or like the country cousin or the country version of Self-Titled. And if let me know if y'all agree or not, but I really feel like that's what it feels like. And I love that for her and I love that for this album and its legacy because I feel like that's definitely what it is. All right, let me get into some things that I love about this album. I guess first thing first for, you know, things I really love about this project, I will say to me is the sequencing. I really feel like the sequencing on this album and the overall story that this album is telling is insane. And I really feel like the way it shifts through, like, you know, different concepts, different subjects, different tones and vibes, it's so seamless. And I will say, while I don't think the transitions on this album were as dope as they were on Renaissance, because I feel like Renaissance just hit a little bit different. I feel like, you know, Renaissance, those transitions between those tracks were just like, it was just, you know, it was goosebumps. Whereas, you know, I don't feel like this album, the transitions didn't feel as dope to me, but they were still amazing and still better than what most of your faves are doing, let's be honest, you know? So I definitely feel like this album is sequenced so well. Each track going into the next makes a lot of sense for the most part. Maybe it could have been some editing in some places, but for the most part, the sequencing is so on point. The transitions are seamless and they're great. And it just really makes this, again, a really great musical experience. This album doesn't feel as long as it does because it's sequenced and put together so well. And I really feel like this is such a great marker of like where Beyonce has been in her life at this time. Like, you know, around this age, she wrote this album a couple years ago, but you know, this album still feels very relevant to like where she's at right now in her personal life. And it just reflects in how expansive it got musically as well. So love it. The next thing I want to highlight on the album that I just love is the vocals, y'all. I feel like everyone has already talked about it, and I have to, you know, mention it for sure. Like, the vocals on this album were amazing. This might be one of Beyoncé's best albums vocally. You know, we still got four. She still did her thing on Renaissance. Every album, she's going crazy. But this album might be an album where I think we really see her just go to a different level vocally. She really tried some different things. And this album, I think, might be her most memorable album vocally. You know, from like the heavy grit and growls that she was able to tap into on several tracks, you know, to the intricate and incredibly complex but beautiful harmonies and background work that she and a lot of the other feature artists were doing on several of these tracks. Like, man, this album was just really in its bag vocally. I was just, as a person, I'm, you know, y'all know me. Y'all can see from the reaction. I love vocals. I love harmonies. I love stacks. I love intricate vocal work. And I feel like Beyoncé fed me deeply with this album. Like, every time I hear these songs, I uncover new things with the vocal work. I uncover new things with the melodies. And it's such an album. It's an album where you can just tell, like, she put so much love and time into crafting, like, every single second of these songs, making sure everything sounded right, just finding ways to, like, weave in beautiful, you know, backgrounds and beautiful harmonies and these beautiful vocal choices throughout all these songs. It was just so well done. And it's something that just makes this album timeless. And it'll really, I think it'll really go down as being one of her best, just off of the vocals alone. Like, you know, tracks in particular I want to highlight: American Requiem, man, Blackbird for sure, shout out to all those ladies as well in the background, My Rose, love that vocal, Daughter, definitely one of the best tracks on the album vocally, that opera section, and just the overall, like, approach he took to that song was gorgeous. Daughter was everything. Flamenco, even though I don't think it was a highlight for the album, that vocal on that track was everything. Yaya, she went crazy on that track, was just trying all these things. It was such a really cool track. I feel like she's never ever sounded like that on any track she's ever done. It was amazing. And Yaya was definitely her doing her best Tina Turner tribute. Can we talk about it? And she killed it. She knocked it out the park. Like, Tina will be proud. She did Tina proud on that track for sure. Oh yeah, so those are some of the tracks that come to mind when I think about just how good the vocals were on this album. But every track was just amazing vocally. So that was definitely, to me, one of the best parts about this album for sure. All right, on to my other favorite parts about this album, and that's definitely the writing. You know, while I feel like while so many of her other albums can also be highlighted for, like, their vocal work and the impressive and expansive and iconic production value, you know, we can look at, you know, albums like, you know, B-Day and 4 and Lemonade for that. So many of her other albums can be marked for just having amazing vocal and production work that's, you know, critical to her catalog and her legacy. Just like this one can be. I feel like this is going to be an album that a lot of people will point to as being their favorite album in terms of her vocal work or the production, because it was both were amazing throughout. But, you know, while I think that's the case, I actually think that this album, to me, stands out in her catalog right now. This one truly stands out for, to me, being the most personal and the most lived in for her, you know, with her most unique and breathtaking writing to date all throughout. I feel like when I think of all of her past albums, I feel like, to me, this is the one that I think I definitely have to point to for having the best set of, like, her best written songs in terms of just, you know, how personal they felt, how well they were actually written, just how well they were arranged, and just how deeply I felt them, you know. So shout out to her and all the songwriters on this album. I really feel like they all just got to a really dope zone on all these tracks. I know there's several different songwriters on several different tracks, but I just think the writing of this album was, like, some of her best to date, and it really made these songs hit a little bit different. Even if they weren't, like, even this album, like, wasn't your favorite, I definitely feel like everyone can agree that, like, this album was, like, one of her most interesting albums to date just because of the writing on this album. I definitely want to highlight tracks that showcase that. In particular, I'd want to highlight American Requiem again, 16 Carriages, what a beautiful song. Protector, for sure. Jolene, I love how she, like, you know, she flipped it and made it, you know, her own updated, you know, modern version. She did it so well. Just for Fun, for sure. That was a really interesting song conceptually. Flamenco, really interesting song, again, conceptually as well. That writing was really interesting, even though it was a short interlude. Yaya, what an epic of a song, lyrically. Like, just talking about so many different things. It was sexy, it was deep, it was just a really interesting record. Yaya, for sure. Two Ants to Heaven, a really deep, beautiful ballad that just had a great groove and a great vibe to it, with such interesting and cinematic and just, you know, poetic lyrics. So those tracks in particular come to mind when I think about the gorgeous writing on this album. And I love how so many of the best written songs on the album, including the ones that I just talked about, really felt like unique to her own story, and they felt unique to her and her life, while also feeling so foundational to the human condition and relatable for everyone to be able to connect to it, you know, to their own life in whatever way possible for them, and be able to, like, you know, really vibe to it in your own way. So now that's kind of like the goal for songwriting, and I really feel like Beyoncé achieved that so well in this album by having songs that these feel like, you know, they're all written for her and, you know, about her, but they also feel like everyone can sing to them and relate to them in their own way and really connect it to their own lives and to their own experiences and to what they're going through. And everyone can just vibe to it in their own way. So I have to just, you know, commend Beyoncé and her team of songwriters for achieving that song after song after song after song. Well done. Even beyond the songwriter, I really feel like as a whole, some of Beyoncé's most beautiful, and I feel like some of her coolest and some of her most interesting songs in her catalog to date, in my opinion, are all on this album. So again, while this is not my favorite album as a whole, some of her best records, in my opinion, in her catalog right now are on this album. I want to highlight in particular, again, American Requiem, 16 Carriages, gorgeous record. Daughter, what a record. That song is so cool. I might even put in there, you know, Two Most Wanted and Levi's Jeans, even though they're not really, but like they go off, so like why not? But also Yaya, one of the most interesting songs in her catalog to date. Riverdance, to me, definitely is one of the most interesting songs she's ever done. That song is so crazy to me. And Two Hands to Heaven, while it might not be like sonically anything, you know, anything new, that song is just so interestingly made and written, and the vibe on that is just so unique. It's one of her most interesting records to date. Yeah, like this, those are songs in particular that come to mind when I just think about some of the most interesting songs she's made so far, and I really feel like those are some of them. So, and they're all on this album, so, you know, kudos. The next thing I want to highlight about this album is definitely the genre exploration that Beyoncé really took with this album, and it was done so well. I really love how this album as a whole is obviously very, you know, predominantly country, and its heart and integrity is with, you know, is with country and blues and soul. That's the main sound and vibe for the album, and, you know, it's obviously done well, and that's what it was supposed to be. But I love how while it's mostly country at its heart, it still has several tracks that show glimpses of, you know, past Beyoncé moments and past Beyoncé songs and, you know, and albums that, you know, that are familiar for longtime fans. And there's other genres blended in here for people that might not be, you know, obviously that into country, but are still here for, you know, the classic Beyoncé sound. You know, so for example, you know, on Daughter, we have like, you know, the Italian and opera, you know, in that song, which is such a new, that's new territory for her for sure. And maybe not so much opera, but like, the, you know, bringing in the Italian aspect was dope. And she doesn't do opera a lot on her albums, you know, compared to like live performances. So that was amazing to just have on an album. You know, on Flamenco, we have like a Latin vibe on Flamenco. That was really interesting as well, even though we've had that before. You know, on Spaghetti and Tyrant and Buckin', we have more of that hip hop vibe, you know, that, you know, is classic for B. And then, you know, on Yaya, we have more of like a rock and roll and funk vibe. That's probably like the only track like it on the album. And then, you know, for more of that, like, you know, that classic like R&B, like alternative R&B sound that we love from Beyoncé, that's on, you know, like Desert Eagle and Two Hands to Heaven. And then we have like more of that like dance sound on, you know, Riverdance and Sweet/Honey. Sweet Honey has more of like a Jersey Club vibe, but, you know, still more of like that dance, you know, that dance vibe. So there's so many different genres that Beyoncé was able to, like, you know, sneak onto the album while everything still felt, you know, country. It still felt bluesy. It felt like, you know, soulful and funky, and everything felt consistent while still being able to like have splashes of all these other genres that we know that Beyoncé can do very well, that she's done before and she's done well. And she was able to incorporate that with this country album and still not make it feel like it wasn't a country album. But at the end of the day, it didn't feel like a regular country album because there was so much on it. And I love that. You know, I love that this album was mostly country, but there was so much going on that it doesn't feel like it's a country album. It feels like a Beyoncé album, like she said. And it feels like one of the most iconic albums of this time, with just how it was put together, with all these genres that are for somehow they all make sense and they all blend well, and they're not fighting for attention, and then they don't sound jarring against each other on this one album. And you know how hard that is to do? So I have to like commend that for sure. And I loved how, you know, the Willie Nelson Smoke Hour interludes and the Linda Martell show, like I love how those interludes were like, you know, just talking about like, you know, not being confined by genres. And Willie Nelson was like, yeah, like, you know, sometimes the best music is when you get put onto shit that you weren't really up on, but like someone put you on and then you got your life. Like, I love how like she really talked about like the fact that she was going crazy with her genre exploration on this album with those interludes, and she used like these legends to talk about it for her, and I love that. And it was everything, it was facts. The next thing I want to talk about on this album is how I really feel like Cowboy Carter was giving us a little bit of a history lesson, and I really love that. Even with the name of the album alone, Cowboy Carter, you know, cowboys, a lot of people don't really realize this, but the name Cowboys actually, you know, came from you know, the degradation of African-American, you know, cowboys, because cowboys used to be known as cowhands. That's what they called the white cowboys back in the day. They called them cowhands, but they called the black cowboys cowboys, and that's how that term came about to this day. A lot of people don't know that. So really, cowboy culture and that name, that word, started really from African-Americans. So we really started this shit, to be honest. And with Carter, even though that's her last name with Jay-Z, like, apparently the Carter family was actually the first family of country music. I don't know much about them, but I looked it up, and I really feel like with the name Cowboy Carter, it's really just like Beyonce harking me back to the start of country music and blackness within country music with those two terms, cowboy and Carter. And that makes sense for her because she's trying to be on her cowboy shit, you know, with this era, and her last name is now Carter. So I really feel like it really came full circle in a really beautiful way. And I love how, you know, she was just giving us a history lesson with just the name of the album alone, and with the imagery, and just so many things that she was able to squeeze onto the album with, like, you know, even like, you know, just having legends on the album like Dolly Parton and Willie Nelson. Even though they're white, they're so integral to the history of, like, you know, country music. And then of course she highlighted so many other, you know, so many of our ancestors and legends and icons in country music, you know, of black ancestry. You know, Linda Martell has, you know, interludes on this album. And with Linda Martell, like I think Linda Martell was one of the, if not the first predominantly, you know, black woman that was trying to really break into the country genre scene in a major way. So I love how she got Linda to be a big part of this album. And that, to me, is another full circle moment that is beautiful to witness. And again, another free history lesson for all the listeners. I love it, man. And speaking of Linda Martell, another thing I really love about this album is how much I really am in love with Beyonce being the bridge on this album between, you know, our ancestors, you know, black people, our ancestors, and, you know, the, you know, black legends and icons in country and rock and roll, you know, people like Linda Martell, like I said, and then some of the samples and the interludes she had on the album, you know, like, we, I think it was like the Smoke Hour 1 interlude, you know, she, we had, you know, we had interpolations of Sunhouse, Sister Rosetta Tharpe, Chuck Berry, Roy Hamilton, you know, on the Smoke Hour interlude. And I think she even had, I think Chuck Berry was on, you know, the, obviously the, that was his song, Oh Louisiana, as well. So I love how she really paid homage to all these black legends in country and rock and roll that paved the way for her to make this album and paved the way for her to get to this moment. While you can see that Beyonce's also being, like, you know, a role model and a legend for the next generation coming up of artists who are trying to be, you know, do the thing in country and rock and roll, like Shaboozy and Willie Jones and all the ladies on Blackbird, you know, Tanner Adele, Raina Roberts, Britney Spencer, and, you know, Tiara Kennedy, like all these women and men, black, beautiful, these beautiful black artists of the next generation. Like, you can see that Beyonce gave them such a beautiful push and exposure with, you know, with their features on this album. And I love that Beyonce is really being a bridge, like I said, between the ancestors and our legends, you know, really giving us that history and, you know, really being present in what she's doing right now, but also paving the way and opening the doors for the next generation coming up of black, you know, country talent. And it's just such a beautiful thing to witness that's happening all on this album. And I don't think we really see moments like this often in music, so we have to cherish them while they're here. I think what Beyonce really did on this album by being this bridge between the past, the present, and the future is something that is so beautiful to witness musically, and also just with how she put it together with the features and the samples and the interludes and all that. It's just really dope, and it's something that I'm so proud of. And, you know, just being black and as someone who, like, country isn't like my genre, but I do appreciate country music. So I just appreciate this moment and what it's doing for black artists within country, past and present and future. I love it. And I hate to be this deep about it, but I'm just go there. I'm gonna be honest. I really feel like this is such a truly monumental project. And I'm grateful that Beyonce went out of her way to give it to us, because while it's so personal for her, like, you can tell this album is like really personal to her. I think this will single-handedly go down as being, you know, a project that truly unified country diehards, including the whites, and people that are not that into country, like, in a way that no other project has. I can't think of a project in recent memory or probably in the future that'll be able to bring people who are, you know, diehard, you know, consistent day one country fans, and people who are not that into country, but are able to appreciate the genre more and really get into it because of the way they were able to access it from this album as maybe their opening door to the genre as a whole. So I really feel like, to me, this is the deepest part about this project, because I really feel like Beyonce is doing something really powerful here, where she is really bridging together two different populations, people who are, we can even make it racial too, like, you know, white people, black people, you know, just people of color versus whites, you know, I don't want to make it that deep, but let's be honest, it's true. But more importantly, just in terms of genre and music, like, she's really bridging together, you know, people who love country and, you know, who've loved it their whole lives versus people who are not really into country, but they're open to it. Like, I really feel like this is going to be an album that really bridges those people together and really connects them and unifies them, because there's so much country on this album. But at the same time, there's also so much, you know, regular Beyonce vibes that, like, both groups can, like, appreciate so much of this album in their own ways and together as well as separately. So it's a really beautiful thing to see how Beyonce was able to achieve that. And I don't even know if that was her goal, but I feel like it is, and I feel like she did it well. And I'm excited to see what it ends up doing for the future of, you know, the unifying of, you know, country diehards versus people who are not that into country. I'm looking forward to seeing it, because I feel like this album will be a seminal album that we'll look back on as an album that really brought together those people for sure, in my opinion. Let's see what happens. And now let me get to a few critiques I have for the album. Really just a few. I don't have many notes for this album. I think obviously for me, and I think for a lot of other people, the main critique for this album is that the album does feel a little bit bloated. I think when you really listen to it, it doesn't feel long because it's such a good album. But I think, you know, at times anybody could say that it feels bloated, whether or not you're listening to it as a whole or even in chunks. Well, definitely not in chunks, but as a whole, this album is really long. And it doesn't feel long, but it definitely is bloated. And I think even the diehard fans, like, even, you know, Beyonce's best fans and most dedicated fans, I could even agree that I think they all have at least like one or two tracks that they probably could have done without. I think every fan has like a few tracks on this album that they didn't hate, but they could have done without and they didn't need. I think every fan has those. And I think the consensus for those tracks as a whole, I would say, let me know if y'all disagree, but I think those tracks that I think a lot of people could do without, you know, everybody has their own picks, but I think most of people agree that those tracks in general tend to be, I think, Alligator Tears, Just For Fun, Flamenco, and Oh Louisiana. So besides like the interludes, I think those are the four tracks that, you know, every fan probably could do without one or a combination of those four tracks. But at the end of the day, those four tracks are still great. But I think those are the four tracks that a lot of people are like, yeah, I could have done without. So to me, this album is great, but I definitely would, to me, it would have been perfect if she had just like shaved off just like a few tracks, like maybe like one, two or three tracks, just to make it a little bit shorter. But actually, I also would have appreciated another smoke hour. I really feel like having a third smoke hour would have been dope, because this album is really long. It's like 27 tracks. I really would have appreciated like one more interlude to really kind of, you know, just kind of bring it together. Like maybe towards the end of the album, I would have loved another smoke hour, like a smoke hour three. I actually would have liked that. I don't know if y'all would have wanted it, but I would have liked it. Because I liked the country radio theme going throughout the album, but I feel like we kind of lost it towards the end and because we didn't have another interlude. So it is what it is. But it's funny because even though I think the album was a little bit bloated, I actually would have loved to have heard a lot of, you know, the other material that was being, you know, made for this album. I would have loved to see, you know, what a lot of the other material sounds like for this album. Like, can we get more, you know, river dances and more ya-yas? Like, I for one am dying to know like what so many of the other tracks on this album were sounding like that got cut for the final version. Like, I would have loved to see and hear what else she was cooking up and what other things she was working on. I really feel like if just the fact that she put Yaya on the album at the last minute, because Yaya is one of the tracks that didn't make the vinyl version. So you could tell Yaya was like a last minute addition to the album. And it's like, if that's a last minute addition, like what else were you making for the album? Like, I want to hear more tracks like Yaya, more tracks like Riverdance, just more tracks that just sound like nothing she's made before. Like, I wonder what else she was baking up for this album, but it's okay. What we got is great. And my last critique for this album, I hate to be that guy, I don't want to be that person, but I have to say it. I would have loved to have gotten some visuals for this album. I know at this point, like, we're done with the visual talk because it's not happening. But, you know, again, after listening to this album, I have to say I would have loved to get some visuals for this album, y'all. Especially tracks like, you know, 16 Carriages, Texas Hold'em, Bodyguard, Daughter, especially Two Most Wanted, Yaya, Riverdance, Two Hands to Heaven, Tyrant. I really feel like I would have loved to have seen what some visuals for these songs would have been like. Man, but it's okay. This era is definitely still beyond iconic already without visuals. But I've definitely, it's just a critique I have because I really feel like, hopefully we'll get them in the future at some point, but whatever. But I really feel like I would have loved to have seen, you know, just some of the visuals for this album and what she could have came up with. But it's not really a critique because this album is already fire without them. But I personally am just like, damn, can we get some visuals? You know what I'm saying? And I appreciate y'all feel the same way. But let me know. But that's really my own critique. That's really my other critique for this album. But it's also a critique that's not that deep. All right, now let me just do a quick track by track review of not every track, obviously, but just some tracks of note for me that I just want to give y'all my quick thoughts on. So first up is American Requiem. I really feel like the declaration and story being told on this song is so bold and it's beautifully executed. And the strong vocal performance and cinematic and grand production, man. And it just resonates and it just gets deeper with each listen. It's such a great intro for the project. And what a way to start this album. What a way to deservedly stake her claim in this new space while dragging America for its BS and celebrating the ancestors who have laid the groundwork for all of us to be here and continue doing the work, especially us Black folk and people of color. Like, what a beautiful track that's just telling this amazing story in this bold and beautiful way. Just, I love that track, so yeah. And I can't say enough about the monumental moment and link up that is Blackbird. Man, such a perfect cover and reimagining of that song that to me is the best version I've heard yet, to be honest. Shout out to the Beatles, but my God. And shout out to Glee version, we love that version too, but man, this is the best version I've heard so far. It's such a beautiful classic record. And just shout out to all those ladies for, you know, for the vocals and for just, you know, them getting together to celebrate each other and to celebrate that song. What a moment. I also want to highlight Levi's Jeans. That little rap sung breakdown after Post's verse in the song, that might be one of my favorite parts of the album. I don't know why. I just feel like that part was so fly, like the vocal, the arrangement. Give you a high fashion in a plain white tee. Like, I just love that part. It was so fly. Like, that to me is like one of my favorite parts of the album musically. Like, just that part right there when she came around after Post's verse. Everything, you know, Levi's Jeans going into Yaya almost like felt perfect, and it kind of feels like flamenco comes in the middle of it, and it almost functions as like a thematic vibe kill. Even though the vocals and the messaging go crazy, it's a beautiful song, it almost feels out of place on the album, and I kind of wish like it didn't kill the vibe of Levi's Jeans going into, you know, Linda Martell and Yaya, which I feel like that would have felt more perfect. But flamenco is still a beautiful song, so it's all good. Yaya to me feels like a whole new age Negro spiritual. You know what I'm saying? Like, and it really feels like it could be the America has a problem of this era. Like, I really feel like, yeah, Yaya to me feels like America has a problem for Act Two. Let me know if y'all feel me on that. I feel like Bodyguard or Tyrant feel like the cuffit of this era. I feel like the cuff of this era will be either Bodyguard or Tyrant. And while, you know, Two Most Wanted is almost kind of like, no offense, it's like kind of like the white, like the pop and country cuffit for this album. You know, it's the next single for the album. This, like, Two Most Wanted feels like the white cuffit, like the pop country cuffit. But like the real, like, you know, the Black cuffit feels like Bodyguard or Tyrant, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, Yaya to me feels like the America has a problem for this era. I love it. It's such a really interesting song. It's so refreshing. And it's such a hodgepodge of all these sounds and topics in one song, but it's done so well. And only Beyonce could pull off a track like this. And she did it. And man, what a vocal on the song. What a vocal. Woo, man. Next up, Old Louisiana. I totally get the purpose of Old Louisiana. I definitely understand why it's in the album and I respect it. Shout out to Miss Tina, you know, mama from Louisiana. Yo, shout out to Miss Tina. But I have to be honest, to me, Old Louisiana is the only real chop on the album for me. For me, it's the only song I don't need at all. But I'm not mad that it's here, but if I had to take off one track, it's Old Louisiana for sure. Next up is Desert Eagle. Beyonce needs to be arrested for making this song as short as it is. This should not have been an interlude. This should have been a full song. You know, cue up that meme, Taraji P. Henson talking about how much she hates how short Jill Scott's Crown Royale is. Because facts, Jill Scott's Crown Royale was too short too. Come on, sis. But yeah, like same thing. Like, you know how Taraji P. Henson was like, Jill, make the song longer. It was too short, sis. It was too short. That's how I feel about Desert Eagle. Desert Eagle should have been a full song. It's so good. It's such a vibe. I'm mad at the interlude. It should have been a full song. It's such a brilliant mix of authentic, you know, country lyrics and metaphors with this like R&B jazz vibe with the production and this like nasty imagery with the lyrics and with that addicting bass riff. It's so good on the ear. Like, it's such a unique song and it's so Beyonce. Oh, I wish it was longer. I'm so mad it's interlude, but it's still a fire track. One of my favorites for sure. Next up is Riverdance. I have to highlight Riverdance for sure. Riverdance is probably my favorite track on this album. I don't even know why, because to me, it's not even the best track in any metric. Like, it's not the best track vocally. It's not the best track production wise, although I could argue that because I love the production on this song. You know, lyrically or conceptually, it's not the deepest or the most, you know, sophisticated song. But for some reason, this song is such a vibe. I don't know. It just does something to me every time I hear it. Like, I just love this song. Riverdance just does something to my spirit. I don't know. Musically, that song is on a different level. You know, that banjo loop, that's so crazy, mixed in with like the piano, that soft piano and the pulsing EDM dance beat underneath it, feels like the perfect bridge, you know, from what she was doing on Renaissance. And I feel like it's unlike anything I've ever heard in her catalog, but it's freaking gorgeous. And I wish more folks gave it love. I feel like not enough people are talking about Riverdance, but to me, Riverdance is like one of the most dopest songs that she's ever made. And it's not the most sophisticated in any sense, but it's just such, like, I don't know, it just hits the soul in a way that I don't think a lot of other songs have in her catalog. It's just such a dope record. It's so fly. It's really operating on a different level. I don't know how to describe it. It just is, you know. To me, it's like the most beautiful black and ghetto and gutter hoedown we've ever heard musically, you know. And shout out to The Dream for, you know, producing it. He killed that. And shout out to my girl Ray on the lyrics. Man, her DNA is all over that song. And she ate down. Like, that song feels like Ray. Her lyrics are all through those verses. It sounds like her. And she killed it. Like, my girl ate it up. Ray, shout out to you. You did that. Such a great song. Man, I love that record. The last track I want to highlight is Tyrant. I really appreciate Tyrant for being another track on the album that is definitely, you know, seeped in country, you know, with the musicality and with the vibes, you know, with definitely, you know, also parts of the lyrics that are so country and also like that Irish fiddle loop that was going throughout the song. Shout out to Dick, got that dope. He killed that sample. That was so dope. That's so country and it sounded great, but also has like that dope, like 808 underneath, like those hard ass hip hop drums underneath was fire. And you know, with those two worlds combined with like the Irish fiddle loop and with the hard ass 808 underneath, like with those two worlds combining on this track in such a dope way, you know, I feel like therefore it really is giving something new to push the culture forward musically in a new way with a really interesting sounding song like this, while also, you know, being accessible for the folks who are trying to get turned and who are used to, you know, the classic Beyonce vibes. This track is brilliant in a way where I feel like, you know, classic Beyonce fans can get turned to it, but country fans who might not be on to Beyonce, who might not be that into Beyonce, can be like, okay, I see what you're doing here with, you know, with the country sounds in it as well. So it's so dope. I love it. But yeah, y'all, so that was a track-by-track review. To end off my review of this project, I guess I'll talk about singles, you know, after Two Most Wanted, because that's the first single that's the next single that Parkwood and Columbia are dishing off the album. It makes a lot of sense. It's the most popular song on the album right now outside of Texas Hold'em. So love that for her and Miley. Great song. I can see it do well for sure. But, you know, after Two Most Wanted, to me, in my opinion, the songs that are fighting, you know, for attention, for, you know, for a single release on the album are definitely, you know, Bodyguard, Jolene, Levi's Jeans, Yaya, Riverdance, and Tyrant. I feel like those songs are all fighting to be future singles, and we'll have to see who prevails in the end. My money is on Bodyguard and Tyrant being actual singles in the future. I could also see Levi Jeans getting a moment. I could see Jolene getting a moment for sure. Yaya and Riverdance, I think, are hopeful. I don't see them happening as singles, but I hope they would. I would love those as singles. I would love those songs as singles, but we'll see what happens. They're all fighting. Let's see who wins in the end. All right, so I guess the last thing I'll say about this album to end it off is, you know, while Renaissance felt like, you know, a sexy, careless night out on the town, you know, on a Saturday night in the city, Cowboy Carter feels like Sunday morning with some sex before church and like a black ass hold down, you know, at night where like everyone in the town is invited and it's all love and it's all, you know, we're all unified, we're all getting to the vibes, but it's black as hell, but everybody's invited. That's what Cowboy Carter feels like. Let me know if y'all feel me in that. If you know, it feels like Sunday morning with some loving, with some freaking up in there before we go to church, and then we're gonna enjoy, you know, some food in the afternoon, and then we're going to the local hold down at night. We're going to the local rodeo. We, you know, it's gonna be black as hell, but everybody in the town is invited. We can all vibe, but it's gonna be a black ass hold down. You feel me? Like, that's what this album feels like. And for that reason alone, I cannot wait to see what Act 3 gives. I'm excited for Act 3. I don't know if it's going to be rock or if it's going to be, you know, R&B or alternative or something else. We'll see, but I'm excited for it. And I have a theory that Act 3 is going to drop on May 29th, 2026. Because so far, we've gotten Renaissance and Cowboy Carter 2 years apart. So I'm assuming we'll have, hopefully, the tour for this album in 2025. And then we'll get Act 3 in 2026. If, you know, if we're keeping the same pattern. And, you know, Renaissance dropped on July 29th. 2022, and Cowboy Carter dropped on March 29th, 2024. So these albums are always dropping on the 29th. So the only date that's 29 on a Friday in 2026 is May 29th, 2026. So I feel like we're gonna get Act 3 in May of 2026, on May 29th. I could be wrong, but if I'm right about that, that'll be so dope. And bookmark it in this video. That I said it, I told y'all. Because I feel like that'll be so dope if we got each album on the 29th of the month. So May 29th, 2026, I'll wait for Act 3. Let's do it. All right, y'all. But to wrap up my review, I will just mention my favorite tracks in the album and my rating. Obviously, I love pretty much all these tracks. I love every track in the album besides Old Louisiana. I don't really need that song. My favorite tracks, this is hard because I love all these tracks. My favorites, I guess, are definitely American Requiem, Blackbird, 16 Carriages for sure, Protector, Texas Hold'em, Bodyguard, Daughter for sure, love that song. Two Most Wanted, definitely. Levi's Jeans, such a bop. Yaya for sure. Desert Eagle, Riverdance, and Tyrant. Those are my favorite tracks, but every track on this album is pretty much amazing. And for my rating for this album, I will give this album a 4.5 out of 5. I know that's a high rating, but I feel like to me this album feels like it's deserving of a 4.5 out of 5 stars. This album is not a perfect album, so it's not gonna get a 5. But to me, it's definitely a 4 and above. But I feel like this album to me feels like 4.5 because I feel like it's so well done. It's such a masterfully curated and executed album, from the vocal production to the actual production, to the lyricism, to the storytelling, to just the nuances with the genres and the different concepts and the different topics. And there's just so much on this album. It really is an album that feeds the soul. It feeds your spirit. You know, it teaches you something. It puts you onto new things and new ideas. I love how there's so many bold statements and ideas on this album. There's so many beautiful things happening on this album, musically, conceptually. It's a really, I think it's one of our best albums in terms of, you know, the package of it. And It really is a really well-made album that to me is one of the best of her career and one of the best of the year so far, and really one of just the best of our time. Like, I think this will be a landmark album of our time, and I'm grateful to be in the era of Beyoncé and to be witnessing in real time her leveling up her artistry and musicality and, you know, album making ability to this level this late in her career. It's insane to be witnessing and to be experiencing in real time, but I'm grateful and I'm honored. And I'm so proud of her. So yeah, this album definitely gets a four and a half out of five stars for me. Let me know what y'all think about that rating down below. But all right, y'all, that was my reaction and my review to Beyoncé's new album, Cowboy Carter. Hope you guys appreciated it. Hope you guys liked it. I know that this was a long video. It was a long reaction and a long review. But thank you to those who have stuck around and watched the whole video. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Let me know what y'all think about the album. Do y'all hate it? Do y'all love it? Do y'all think it was okay? It could have been better. I'm assuming y'all love it like I do. But if you hate the album, or if you feel like it was mid, it could have been a little bit better, let me know why down below. If you love the album, let me know why down below. Let me know what are your favorite tracks, your least favorite tracks. Let me know what you think about the album in terms of, you know, how it's sequenced. You feel like it should have been edited to, you know, be, you know, have a different track listing. Let me know if you, you know, you think some tracks are, you know, you could done without some tracks. Let me know what your favorites. Let me know what you think about Beyoncé in terms of, you know, the way her and her team will promote the album in the next year or two. Let me know if you have ideas for them or things that you want from this era that have not happened yet. Let me know down below as well. Appreciate y'all. If you haven't already, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And please go support my Patreon. But all right, y'all, this has been your boy Bright, the R&B Kid. Thank you for watching. But for now, I'm signing off, baby. Bye, y'all. Peace.
I came to vibe. You came to function just to that, baby. Don't worry about nothing. No, 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 no. I came to vibe. You came to function just through that, baby. Don't worry about nothing, no, no, no. Relax just a little bit. You don't gotta worry, you can just